Curlew in Autumn, a thriller serial for radio in 6 episodes by Edward Boyd, with David Ashton as Peter Calman. Episode 1.
Whatever they were waiting for was about to happen now. And suddenly I became aware of something. Something I hadn't noticed. Something that perhaps had not been there to notice. All of them, every last one of them, was carrying or wearing some kind of timepiece. Some had watches the size of pumpkins. There were watches in gold and silver, in porcelain and platinum, in metals hitherto unknown. Clocks of every shape and of every size except small. Clocks of astonishing ingenuity, and some as perverse as bad taste could achieve. One was haloed with seashells, another nestled in a miniature life belt, one doubled as the navel of some weird masculine fantasy, another was embedded in a dead man's skull. One old crone carried appropriately a grandfather clock. The village idiot, unwittingly non-conformist, proudly displayed a sundial. Suddenly, the crowd was silent, and there appeared a tiny man, stepping daintily from the doorway of his house, to be greeted by a cacophony of clock noise, bells, chimes, cuckoos, and buzzers. Get lost, whoever you are.
I am Magda von Schellenberg.
Never heard of you.
Oh, people don't speak to me like that.
God almighty, it is 4 o'clock in the morning.
Not where I am.
And wherever you are is the center of the universe.
I am in New York.
Give my regards to Broadway.
Short, sharp burst of biography. On the office door, it says in faded gilt lettering, Calman and Calman, solicitors. One of them is me, Peter Douglas Calman. The other Calman had his first and last cornery 2 years ago. He was my uncle. Anything else? Well, yes, I am. And yes, I did. I remember it all and how it ended. Face downward in the Twickenham mud. And I remember the man who did it. And for him, there is an uneasy room in hell. After 4 o'clock in the morning, the experts say things can only get better. I don't agree. After 4 o'clock in the morning, you only get 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on. The world gets lighter, but not on that account brighter. 9 o'clock? Breakfast survived, carbuncular porridge, cremated toast, washed down with an instant something. 9 o'clock, and off to the office, where a man awaited me, 40-ish, sturdy, shaved so close it must have been done from the inside, wearing thick tweeds that had been bought from a mail-order catalogue 20 years ago.
A fine morning, Mr. Calman.
You're on the road early this morning, Jock.
Maybe draw out your rain later on.
What is it, Jock?
I thought I would tell you myself. I mean, are a pride of you, see what I mean?
No, Jock, I don't.
I'm talking about the wife.
Well, there's nothing wrong with her, I hope.
No, she's right as the mail. It's just that... What I'm trying to get round to is that she'll no be coming back.
Back to work, you mean?
Aye, just so.
Well, I thought she was quite contented.
Oh, she is. She is. You mustn't blame her.
Well, there's no question of blame involved.
I've been idle now these 2 years. And they tell me it's no as bad as it was in my father's day. I think it is, Mr. Calman, every bit as bad.
At least you don't have to starve nowadays.
When I married Mary, there was nothing in the bargain about her keeping me.
So that's it.
That's it.
Some folk might say you're being a bit selfish.
Mary and me have been into all that.
Then there's nothing more to be said.
I've no right to say this, Mr. Calman.
Say it anyway.
Mary thought you might no be sorry to see her go.
What put that into her head?
She says it might help having one less wage to pay.
She dreamed that up all by herself.
There's a rumour going around that you're having a bad time financially.
He would say no more, but shortly afterwards took his clumsy leave and clumped out into the morning street that smelled of last night's frost and today's new bread. I sat there, helping nothing to happen. 'Twas all as exciting as watching cow dung harden. Nobody called to invite me to appear on This Is Your Life, or to breathe heavily at me, or to explain to me why Mary should suddenly desert the sinking ship, and who had mentioned to her that the ship was sinking. You could feel the morning freshness wear off like makeup, and the early silence was raped and raped and raped again by the heavy lorries pounding along the A75 to Stranraer, trying not to kill too many people on the way. And the farmers' wives had come to town, and the supermarket screeched with shopping trolleys, and the licensed grocers were doing a land office business, and it was time for my appointment at the bank.
Mr. Anderson will see you in a moment.
What is he doing?
Mr. Anderson.
Feeding sugar lumps to the computer?
Mr. Anderson.
Call him Piggy. Everybody else does.
Well, everyone else doesn't work for him.
You could be wrong there.
You can go in now.
Thank you.
Mr. Anderson was my bank manager, and there was nothing wrong with him that death wouldn't cure. We'd been at school together, and there were other things we once had in common, like Alice Watson name, who used to go to church with him on Sunday mornings, and to extreme lengths with me on Sunday afternoons.
Ah, oh, good of you to drop in, Peter.
Come off it, Piggy.
I wish you wouldn't call me that.
No?
Especially...
with my overdraft. Was that what you were about to say?
Especially in front of my staff.
Can I do it behind your back?
I can't stop you.
Can you stop yourself?
What does that mean?
Jock Matheson came to see me this morning.
Well?
He more or less told me I was broke.
He more or less told you the truth.
Yes, but where did he hear it?
His wife works in your office?
Mary has worked for me for almost 10 years. She wouldn't have lasted 10 minutes if you hadn't been trustworthy.
Could we discuss this overdraft
of
yours?
Just let me say this first.
If you must.
Mary's husband has been out of work a long time. The chances are he'll never work again. That doesn't stop him hanging round the cattle market the way old boxers hang round the gym.
I'm afraid...
And so you bloody well should be. You're not averse to hanging round the cattle market yourself, Piggy.
Business takes me there, occasionally.
And you can't talk business all the time you're there, can you?
You know how farmers love to gossip.
Only too well.
I'm not going to discuss this a minute longer, Calman. To begin with, I haven't the time. Secondly, you have already made up your mind that I am responsible for what people are saying.
Well, aren't you, Piggy?
What do you intend doing to reduce this overdraft?
He was a smooth customer, in the way that rocks can be smooth. And when we parted frostily, half an hour later, he took my checkbook and my credit cards, but allowed me to keep my contempt for him and my conviction that I was getting the best part of the bargain. The town's main street was swarming now with people. The shops blazoned forth, each its heraldic smell. Warm and yeasty from the bakers, from the ironmonger, the crucifixion smell of nails. The garden shop held suspended the scents of next year's spring, and from the Church of Scotland bookshop, the sour, bleak odour of sanctity. And high above them all, yellow...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.